Yeah.
This week on Sportsman TV, Reed's Metal Building. Come on, go with us. There you go.
Now that fish caught me on the way up. He was suspended. It's rats. That would be our first Lake Okissa bass. we just started on a point and fishing some grass and some pads, and we're just fishing what looks good right now until they tell us this will be my maiden voyage to Lake Okissa. So that fish there was actually suspended. I was reeling my jig up and he got it. So he was high in the water column. He came out of that grass, but beautiful hydrilla, beautiful day. I'm pretty excited to say the least. We're in southern Mississippi fishing Lake Okissa, a new lake to Sportsman TV and a new lake to me. You know, I had heard about it, but never had the opportunity to fish here. You would think no farther than it is from my house that I would, but I try to stay as far as away from home as I can most of the year. So, but a cool place, by far the deepest water other than the Gulf of Mexico that's close to my house. I mean, some of the lake we've been in this morning, some parts of it, 60 feet. It's full of hydrilla, it's full of lily pads, you know, really clear water, really pretty place. It's just, we kind of in that experimental stage of it right now. I've started out fishing some hydrilla. I mean, you know, just going by the way it looks, I mean, swimming a jig, throwing a frog. I mean, there's just a lot of options here until we find out what the majority of those fish are doing. We have great conditions today. Water temperature 65, which is, you know, really close to being optimal. I mean, it's just setting up. It could be, you know, the day of all days is what we're hoping for. But, you know, typical fisherman, I always stay pretty confident. I let them beat me down, you know, before I say it's not gonna happen. But cool place, very unique to our area. You know, we're used to going to the marsh or in the basin, and just totally different style of lake. A lot of offshore structure. I did a little bit of graphing around this morning before we fished, deep timber in 50 and 60 foot of water. It's just cool because it gives us an opportunity to do something a little different, you know, kind of from the norm. Oh, I'm just tying a fluorocarbon leader. I like, you know, when the water's this clear fishing for bass, a lot of times it will help you get a few extra bites by using a fluorocarbon leader. I'm only using, you know, maybe 5 or 6 feet. The braid is 15 and this leader is 16. And because of the, like a lot of times I'll use a lot smaller leader than that, but because of the lake that we're on has potential for catching a big one, you know, I like a little bit bigger leader. I attached the two lines together with a knot called a Crazy Alberto. And really what makes it so good is it's not that big a knot and it comes through the guides pretty easy. And really probably the two best knots out there for attaching fluorocarbon to braid, you know, and making a casting knot is either that Crazy Alberto or an FG knot. But I'm just Texas rigging, an Ocho, which is basically just a straight worm. And it actually has a really unique fall in that worm, just when it's on a slack line, it quivers. is, which is something that, you know, bass really, really like. Especially in clear water, it's not a dirty water deal. It's a clear water deal, and it also helps if you can find everything you're looking for. But you can wacky rig it, which is hooking it in the middle, which is when you're not fishing around cover. Like if this was just straight grass with not those stumps scattered in it, I'll probably lean more towards the wacky rig. But since there's, you know, stumps mixed in, I like the Texas rig the best, which is basically just burying the worm in the hook. We've had this rigged up. I'm putting an 1/8 ounce tungsten weight on there to make sure now we're going. There hadn't seemed to be any fish up close to the surface off the edge of that grass. And so I'm putting an 1/8 ounce weight on there, you know, so it'll get down. And still, it probably won't fall to the bottom. It'll just get down in the grass a little more than just floating around out on the outside edge. Now, again, we still don't know yet if they're in the grass or not, or if it's a timing deal or what. We're still experimenting, so. But regardless, typically, anytime you have grass, there'll be some fish relating to it. Now, the deal is figuring out if they're out on the outside edge of it, or are they buried up, and they could be even shallower, you know, deeper in the grass than we fished so far. We haven't really fished much shallow. We've pretty much stayed just right on that deep edge of the grass. So. All right, so I pegged that weight with a rubber peg, and that way the weight won't slide up and down the line. Because what'll happen if you don't peg it and you cast it out there in the grass, that weight will, a lot of times, will the bait will hang in the grass and the weight will slip away from it. And this way, that'll has a better chance of pulling that worm down in that grass behind it.
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah.
Don't reel him up too close. Don't reel him up any closer than what he is. Now, you know what I'm saying? Don't just drag him over here. How about that?
Heck yeah.
How about that?
Can you get a picture of my phone real quick?
Yes, sir. All the pictures you need. He acts like he's excited about that, doesn't he? Jackpot. He was suspended, but he was down, you know, 8 or 9 foot deep. He wasn't shallow. He caught that jig on the way down. Well, you know, right now that's a 1 ounce hack attack jig, heavy cover flipping jig. And I got it on 50 pound braid, and that's just, you know, it's a good way to catch big ones. And it's a good way to find them in that grass, because basically with it, I'm covering from the surface to the bottom to 15 foot. It falls fast, you know, so it goes through that hydrilla. And, but you know, we haven't decided yet if they're in the grass or not, but it's just a good way. It's a fast presentation. You know, it falls through there quick, gets to the bottom. And it resembles a bluegill or a crawfish, you know, going through that hydrilla. And which a lot of times those fish in that grass, you know, that's what they're, if there's fish in the grass, chances are that's what they're feeding on. If the fish are, you know, if they end up being outside it, chances are they're feeding on shad. Now, I was talking about one being skinnier earlier. I think that one's a little skinnier than the last, but that's the kind of fish I target because I know they're hungry. You know, it's funny. I got 2 bites here this morning. This is where we started. Like the first cast, you know, I thought I got a bite, and then I caught one right after that, and then we fished and fished and fished, and you know, it could be a timing deal. I mean, I just pulled up there, first flip in, you know, and got that bite, so.
That's a big one right there. Yep.
I told you.
Wow.
Not as good as I thought, but I thought I was like, that one bit like it was supposed to. That sucker slacked the line.
How big is he?
He's probably 4 pounds or so, maybe a hair bigger. He's a little bit healthier than those other fish. I got a 1 ounce jig, and I mean, I'll use at times up to 1 ounce and a quarter doing this. Water's a little cooler, so I don't want to go bigger than an ounce. And I got a rage crawl in the back of it. And basically what I'm doing, I'm flipping it out there to the edge of the grass, and I'm pulling a bunch of slack in my line, if you can see it on the surface, because I want that bait to fall naturally. There's a couple reasons for that. You get more bites when it's falling like that. It's just a more natural presentation. And then the other deal is I get to see a lot of those bites because I'm watching that line, that braid's floating on the surface. So if it ever kicks or does something weird, you know, I see it. Because a lot of times these fish are suspended in that grass like that, and they'll catch that bait on the way down. And it just seems like when you're free spooling that jig out there like that, those suspended fish are more apt to bite it than if you were controlling it. You know, what you don't want to do, I mean, you know, there'll be situations when this grass is so deep, a couple times I've had to feed it a little line, you know, to keep it falling on a slack line. But I try to roll my slack. Each time I pitch, I lift my rod up and I just let my reel free spool because I want, you know, extra slack because I'm watching that bait. Now, these fish are down close to the bottom. I've had a couple that were up higher. But the last couple bites have been deep, like, you know, 15, 16 foot down on the bottom. And so I'll lift it and shake it a couple times and then reel it in and pitch it again. Most of the time fishing, regardless if you're punching mats that are, you know, got 15 foot of water under them or got 2 foot, you know, you get more bites than not on that initial, you know, that jig just blows out into an opening through that grass and those fish react to it. You know, it looks like a bluegill or a crawfish, you know, blowing through the grass. But big key is being able to make that pitch on a slack line so you can watch that bait fall.
Just like that.
But that's the deal, watching that line, the instant it makes any kind of move, you know they got it. Just a slight. And that's the cool thing about braid, you know, being able to see that. And just like him throwing that worm with that leader, your strike indicator is the braid. It's not the fluorocarbon that the worm's tied on. Oh yeah. You want me to go to him? Well, I think the biggest reason, you know, now is they're just starting to show up. Like, they're getting in an aggressive position. You know what I'm saying? I guess it would be the deal is, you know, when you're not active, you're home in your bedroom with the door closed. And then all of a sudden you come outside when everything's right. You know what I'm saying? It's just, fish are kind of that same way. Well, when they're not in an aggressive posture, especially when as much cover as we have, I mean, we basically got grass from 20 foot deep to the bank and that grows 20 foot tall. You know, it's not like it's just grass out here. I mean, this grass is standing 20 foot tall. And, you know, when those fish, I don't know if they've, I really want to think they were just buried up in the grass and they just started coming up and they got aggressive this afternoon.
I mean, like a big, big one, if I can get him out.
Or if he went out in a tree or something. Oh, he's still on there. Oh, come out of there. God, it's a big one. Went down in the tree. I couldn't get him out. He's still on there. See? He's still on there.
Here he comes, here he comes.
Oh, yeah.
Ooh.
Nice. I thought it was going to be a big, big one, but it is a nice one. Isn't that something? Hadn't been around any tree, but he found one. I'm using a green pumpkin 1 ounce hack attack jig. Now I've changed trailers rather than just change the jig color. I've changed colors. That's a candy crawl trailer. And that's the one that most of my bites have come on today. You know, to me, you know, the jig is important, but without the trailer, it's useless. I mean, and so that I've been just changing the color of the rage crawl rather than cutting off a new jig to see, but in that clear water, you know, it's just a bluegill color. I mean, that's basically what I'm trying to represent swimming through that grass, you know, as a bluegill. And it, you know, this is kind of that live by the sword, die by the sword deal. When this deal's good, you can't beat it, but you can go hours without a bite. It's kind of that deal we had run into today this morning. I did it so much because I thought it was the right deal, just looking at the conditions and looking at the grass and what seemed like a waste of time. And then it's just, you know, when it's a timing deal, it's just like you, all of a sudden, I had more bites in the last 15 minutes than I'd had in the previous 6 hours. A little one. But I said to Hook like he was big. I thought it might be. He slipped up on me a little bit. I was like, I saw that line get weird and I didn't check it. And then I checked, I was like, still looks funny. And I checked it and I knew one had it. That fish was up close to the bait hadn't, it was funny. I'm watching, it's a whole deal watching the line. But the deal about it was that fish was in the top of that grass. I mean, that bait hadn't fell 2 foot. I saw it and I was like, I know that's a bite, but I know it hadn't got down yet. Now that's the first one that's been up, you know, been up that high. It's a pretty fish. You know, but you can come here and flip deep grass. I mean, I'm sure it's got good topwater bait fishing. It's just a very unique lake. You know, it's the only place I know of in close proximity, you know, to my house where I can graph fish. It's deep enough to get over them with your electronics and, you know, actually sight fish with your electronics. I will be honest with you, I was not prepared today, you know, for the type of lake. I didn't know, you know, I didn't do enough research about it to know all about it. But when I got here and saw that it had deep hydrilla, I'll be honest with you, this is all I wanted to do. Because this is just a great way to catch a big one. This is a trophy lake. I have been happy about, you know, the way I fish today, or, you know, the way I'm getting to fish today, but I have noticed there's a lot of options, a lot of things that, you know, you could do here. You know, we wrapped the fishing up at Lake Okissa today, and now we've come back. We know Bernie's a fisherman, but now we're gonna know what he really is a master of. We're here at his business in Brookhaven, Mississippi, and he's gonna show us some things that they do, you know, their manufacturing process, and just, you know, what they offer out there for someone that's in the metal building needs.
We manufacture metal roofing. We do 7 different profiles. Any type of metal roofing, whether it's commercial, residential, banks, high-end type buildings, or it's just a regular old fishing camp with some old corrugated or 5E10 on it. We do all 7 profiles here. We have over 20 colors to choose from, and our slogan is order today, pick up today. You can walk in, sit down with a sales rep. They'll help you figure out what you need. And within 45 minutes, you'll be going home with a custom cut roof. We do metal buildings, all types of agricultural buildings, pole barns, pretty much anything to do with a house roof, or a metal building or a pole barn.
So if a guy wants to build him a camp, metal building, you're the guy he needs to be calling.
We can do it. We do a lot of fishing camps, a lot of hunting camps. This here building basically just shows all the different options. It shows a roof extension out the front, shows a lean-to off the side. It shows also with a canopy off the other side, solid door, half glass door, with insulation, without insulation, with liner panel, without liner panel. So basically you can come out and look at this building and just pick out what you want, and then we'll custom build it to whatever you would like to have. This here is one of our agricultural pole barns. We offer it in several different ways. We've got 2x6s, wood trusses on this side, on 2-foot centers. And then we have metal purlins on this side that are on 4-foot centers. This is a 1-piece purlin from one end to the other, so it's much stronger. And we also offer these in galvanized trusses and galvanized purlins on wood post. Anything within 50 miles of the coastline, that's what a lot of people decide to go with.
Well, I'm about ready to have my building built. So how many locations do I have to choose from?
We have seven manufacturers. We have one in Missouri, one in Lake Charles, Louisiana, Benton, Arkansas, Jackson, Tennessee, Tupelo, Mississippi. Our corporate office is here in Brookhaven, Mississippi, and we just now opened one up in Cross City, Florida. So we got you covered. Doesn't matter what state you lived in. I heard you talking earlier from Hot Springs area. You know, we got a great manufacturer store in Benton as well.
So I have no excuses.
No excuses.
It's a done deal.
To use Reed's Metals.
I hear you. Thank you very much, and we enjoyed it.
Enjoyed it. Thank you.
You know, we caught some fish today, but the main thing we learned about Reed's Metal Buildings. Join us here next time on Sportsman TV.